Brothers and sisters, my text this morning is the blackness of black. And a congregation of voices answered,
That blackness is most black, brother, most black.
In the beginning,
at the very start,
they cried, there was blackness.
Reach it.
And the sun,
the sun, Lord,
was bloody red.
Red.
Now black is, the preacher shouted.
Bloody.
I say black is.
Preach it, brother.
And black ain't.
Red, Lord, red. He said it's red.
Amen, brother.
Black will get you.
Yes, it will.
Yes, it will.
And black won't.
No, it won't.
It do.
It do, Lord.
And it don't.
Hallelujah.
Invisible Man, Prologue. In this excerpt from the marijuana-induced dream of the prologue, the fiery religious dialogue paints the typical image of the all-black mass. One can almost envision the fanfare of the invigorated congregation as they passionately throw their fists in the air and hang on to every word coming out of the preacher's mouth.
So now, gentlemen, I want you to give him your attention.
We of the younger generation extol the wisdom of that great leader and educator, I shouted, who first spoke these flaming words of wisdom. A ship lost at sea for many days suddenly sighted a friendly vessel. From the mast of the unfortunate vessel was seen a signal. Water, water, we die of thirst. The answer from the friendly vessel came back. Cast down your bucket where you are. I spoke automatically and with such fervor that I did not realize that the men were still talking and laughing until my dry mouth, filling up with blood from the cut, almost strangled me. I used the phrase social responsibility and they yelled,
What's that word you say, boy?
Social responsibility, I said.
What?
Social.
Louder.
Responsibility.
More.
Respond.
Repeat.
Civility.
What?
Equality.
Say that slowly, son.
Social responsibility, sir.
You weren't trying to be smart, were you, boy?
No, sir.
Invisible Man, Chapter 1.
Now, at this point of the novel, in this scene, we are presented with a dignified black man, our protagonist, addressing a crowd of white men. Now, up to now, this is actually the most eloquent and well-performed speech in the entire novel. He is presented as the best speaker up to this point, being a black man, you must know. And what happens as he gives this speech is the white crowd is actually being restless. We're presented with the image of the white drunk man saying unintelligible, nonsensical comments at the speaker, who is a black man. And we are given an ironic juxtaposition, the image of the white drunk man and the dignified black man.
Will you promise to tell me my fate?
I heard. Sir?
Will you?
Right now, sir? I asked with embarrassment.
It is up to you. Now, if you like.
I was silent. His voice was serious, demanding. I could think of no reply. I don't know now, sir. This is only my junior year.
But you'll tell me when you know.
I'll try, sir.
Good.
I wanted to ask him if being rich and famous was enough. But I was afraid.
What do you think of my idea, young man?
I don't know, sir. I only think that you have what you're looking for. Because if I fail or leave school, it doesn't seem to me it would be your fault. Because you helped make the school what it is.
And you think that enough?
Yes, sir. That's what the president tells us. You've got yours, and you got it yourself. And we have to lift ourselves up the same way.
Invisible Man, Chapter 2.
In this dialogue from Chapter 2 of The Invisible Man, we have our protagonist, the Invisible Man, seated in the front of a car, driving around a wealthy co-founder of the Black University where he's a student. Now, we see that our protagonist has a lot of really deep, sensitive thoughts going on in his head, a lot of sophisticated thinking, but he can't really convey any of it to the white man. And it goes to illustrate the fact that in this society, during this time, no matter how comfortable a black man felt, it was ingrained into them that you do not talk like that with a white man. You have to remain subservient, lower than the white man. Because in this time, the black men were always second-class citizens. No matter how sophisticated, dignified they may be, they were still considered lower, and we see a great illustration of that in this dialogue.
But I got mad when I found they was trying to get rid of us, because they said we was a disgrace. Yes, sir, I got real mad. So I went down to see Mr. Buchanan, the boss, man, and I told him about it, and he gave me a note to the sheriff and told me to take it to him. I did that, just like he told me. I went to the jailhouse and gave Sheriff Barber the note, and he asked me to tell him what happened. And I told him, and he called in some more men, and they made me tell it again.
Invisible Man, Chapter 2. In this excerpt from the narrative of Jim Trueblood, the country dialect creates the image of the poor, uneducated black farmer in the reader's head. This image, of course, is in stark contrast with that of the more refined protagonist. And I think to myself, the various voices and speaking styles found in The Invisible Man, particularly when juxtaposed with the speaking style and voice of the protagonist, create varying images of different people with different socioeconomic status within the novel. The bright, blessed day. Ralph Ellison clearly demonstrates the power of voice as a tool in manipulating the senses. My mama was raised in the era when clean water was only served to the fairer skin. Doing clothes, you would have thought I had help, but they wasn't satisfied unless I picked the cotton myself. You see, it's broke, nigga, race him. That's that don't touch anything in the stove. And it's rich, nigga, race him. That's that come in, please buy more. What you want? A Bentley, fur coat, a diamond chain? All you blacks want all the same thing. Used to only be niggas. Everybody playing, spending anything on Alexander Wang, new slaves.